said, if you listen carefully to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his eyes, if you pay attention to his commands and keep all his decrees, I will not bring on you any of the diseases I have brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. Welcome to How to Improve Your Health Using Biblical Principles. I am Arlene Robinson. With me is Dr. Robert Robinson. And together we're going to explore biblical principles that will help us to have optimal health. Let me just give this back to you.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. To begin our program today, we're going to review last week's program where we looked at the Bible and health. World health statistics show major deterioration in human health. All of us could attest to this because all of us know someone who is sick, and we realize that we are much sicker today than our parents and grandparents were. This, despite the fact that the Bible indicates a higher degree of health for us. In fact, God said in Genesis that we should live to 120 years. It's the psalmist observing some years later that we were barely crossing 70 and we felt really good if we reached 80, but this is nowhere near God's standard. God says we are fearfully and wonderfully made, and when we look at this epidemic of diseases going on now, we realize something is really off. What is off is the fact that we as human beings are not working with the manual that comes with us. That is, God made us, he gave us the Bible, and if we apply these biblical principles, we will do much better. We've seen it with scientists, early scientists who were Christians, and they applied biblical principles and were able to come up with the germ theory and antibiotics and other stuff. And there's an incredible example of how applying biblical principles will keep us healthy. For example, when the bubonic plague or Black Death broke out in Europe, about 70 million people died. But the Jews, they were doing quite well, to the point where the people thought the Jews must be causing this. All they were doing was living by the principles God had given them for hygiene and diet and so. And they did very well.
Yeah, one of the things you mentioned, Arlene, is that the Bible talks about the human lifespan should be 120 years. Mm-hmm. This is consistent with what we are finding in science. If you actually study the genes and you study what happens to the genes as you get older, there are some changes that occur at the end of the gene. They call it the telomere. And based on the calculation, these telomeres should last 120 years before the genes begin to deteriorate. So it is estimated in science that the lifespan of a human being should be 120 years, which is consistent with what God said in Genesis 6, verse 3, that the lifespan is 120 years.
So we see that God's word and God's work working in tandem still.
With each other, right.
Okay, so today we're going to look at Exodus 16 and the sabbatical diet. Let's just review what Exodus 16 is about. This is the story of God moving the children of Israel from Egypt to the promised land. He is in charge of the menu. He provides the food for them. He provided manna and quails, and he gave Moses instructions how this food should be consumed.
And this was basically the diet they followed for 40 years while they were in the desert. Mm-hmm. And we know that when they had completed the journey in the desert, that their health was excellent. I mean, Moses was actually 120 years at that point. And in fact, there was a description about how his eyes were, how his health was, and he said it was excellent. So obviously, if we study this, how did the Israelites feed and eat and consume food during this period, we will learn a lot of principles which we can apply today.
Well, that's what we're going to do. I'm sure there are many of us, especially we ladies who want to look young and live long forever. We're going to check out these principles, and if we apply them, we're going to reap the benefits. So we're continuing in Exodus 16, and we're going to see how it demonstrates the biblical principle of the pattern of eating. Now, let's look at the meaning of the word pattern. A pattern is a sequence of events. For example, if you're driving a car, I think we learn to drive with gear shift things these days.
Standard.
That's what we call it, yes. Standard. And if you need to change your gear, you have to press the clutch, right. Engage the gear, then let it go easily and bring in the gas, and it's a whole heap of balancing sequence.
Yes.
If we just ignore the sequence and decide we're just going to ram in a gear and do our own thing, we're going to do tremendous damage to the vehicle. Yes, exactly. Plus, we might shut down and all the drivers start to cuss, and it will not be pretty out there.
You might need a new gearbox if you don't follow the procedures properly. So it's important that the pattern is followed when you're changing gears in a standard vehicle. Yes.
Right. Now, for those of us who don't drive, most of us have to wash clothes.
Yes.
And it's one of the sequences we have to follow. You don't just fling all the clothes together in the machine. You have to separate the whites from the colored, because the colored could bleed onto the whites and you damage all your clothes. Mm-hmm. So there are sequences for every little thing we do in life if we want to maximize it. So let's look at the pattern of eating, or the sequence of meal consumption.
Well, just the same way as how, as you mentioned, in your car and also washing your clothes, you can do damage to your clothes or damage to the car if you don't follow a particular pattern in the way you execute it. It's same thing applied to food consumption. If you're not consuming food in the right pattern, then you're likely to cause damage to your body. I mean, although food is good for our body, if food can also be bad if it is not used properly. A lot of the diseases that we are seeing is because people are not consuming food in the right pattern. So just the same way with the car, you damage the gearbox. If you don't consume food properly, you can damage your body. And this can lead to a number of diseases. And also, you would not achieve optimal health.
Right.
And as we pointed out, the lifespan is going to be short. So, and most people's lifespan now are decreased by over 40 years.
Because you have a number of young people. We have some young people, 21, 22.
Yes, yes.
And we have very high blood pressures, which could eventually lick the kidney before they reach 30.
Right, right.
So we have to be careful and find the pattern God has set up for us.
Yes, yes.
Now, let's see what Exodus 16 has to say about breakfast and the pattern of eating. Full, heavy breakfast before noon is what Exodus 16 says. There are at least four verses in there that will emphasize this. If you have your Bibles, you should be in Exodus 16 by now. And we're going to be looking, starting with verse 8. You want to read it for us?
Okay, in Exodus 16, verse 8, and I'm reading from the NIV. And Moses said, "This shall be when the Lord shall give you in the evening flesh to eat, and in the morning bread to the full."
You notice the bread in the morning is to be to the full.
Right. Yeah.
Right. So we're not going to just grab a bite and run off to work. We have to set our schedule so we could have bread to the full.
Right. The bread here is not the same as the bread dough that we consume. We're going to look at this a little more, because this is manna and so on. And we'll describe a little later what manna is like. But the same point is also brought out in Exodus 16, verse 12 and verse 16, where again Moses points out to them that they must eat the bread or the manna to the full, or they should be filled with bread, rather. That's what he says in verse 12. And in verse 16, points out that every man should eat according to his needs, right.
So we're not going to be gluttonous.
Right, so what he's showing that you should have a full meal in the morning, a full breakfast, and that you shouldn't be gluttonous. You know, you should be eating according to your needs and so on. Okay. All right. So that the first three verses, these three verses point out the importance of having a full breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
But the key verse in Exodus 16 that we shouldn't miss is verse 21, which a very interesting thing happened there. And if you're following your Bible, just follow and read between verse 16 and 20. But just to give a little synopsis of what is happening. Moses obviously has given tell the Israelites how to eat the food, right?
Yeah.
And they started eating the food just as how he had instructed them to do.
Mm-hmm.
But somewhere along the line, some of these guys decided they are not going to eat the food according to the instruction that Moses gave. They are going to keep back some of the manna. I might even eat some in the evening, or even keep some to the following morning.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And what we found happened is that maggots began to grow in the manna.
In the manna.
So the manna began to spoiled. Mm-hmm. And obviously, Moses was very upset because, I mean, Moses is telling them, this is how the Lord say you must do, how you must consume the manna. Why are you doing it your own way? And this is why we're having this problem right. in the camp. Mm-hmm. Now, verse 21 comes in, and verse 21 is very interesting. Because after Moses is very upset, you see a very interesting passage. Verse comes in. And listen to what this verse says. And they gathered in every morning, every man according to his eating. And when the sun waxed hot, it melted. Now, at first glance, you probably don't see what is happening here. But the sun gets hot 12 o'clock. When an Israelite yes. says the mm-hmm. sun gets hot, or when the sun is hot, he's talking about noon. Now, what is happening? The manna is melting at noon.
Yeah.
But before verse 21, it was not melting at noon.
Yeah,
because they were keeping some mm-hmm. later on in the evening and even to the following morning. No, there's only one person that can change the manna from being not melting at noon to be melting at noon, and that is God.
Mm-hmm.
So what has happened is that God has now stepped in into the situation and said, well, look, since you guys are not going to follow what Moses is telling you to do, mm-hmm. I am going to cause the manna, I'm going to change the properties of the manna and cause it to melt at 12 o'clock. So you either eat what you're supposed to mm-hmm. eat in the morning or you get none. It's one or the other. So what God is saying is non-negotiable. What God is saying is that you must consume this food before 12. And that is critical to the sabbatical diet. And we're going to look at it later on and see there's a lot of scientific evidence why this should occur before 12 o'clock. But in the Bible itself, you can see the point being emphasized that you must have a full meal or this full breakfast before 12 o'clock.
Well, I guess God knowing how he made us
yes.
and realizing we wouldn't last if we don't eat this way, if we keep violating right. what he says.
Mm.
He just melts it at 12, so it's non-negotiable.
It's non-negotiable.
You, get it in before,
you must have that heavy meal before 12.
Mm-hmm.
And this they did 6 days
right.
during the week. As you read the passage, you'll read more about how they did that. They did it 6 days.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. So what we're going to do now, we're going to go on the streets of Jamaica and find out
mm-hmm.
what the general public thinks is a proper diet
okay.
to see how close to the right thing we are.
We are.
So let's just view the Vox Pop now.
I believe that a balanced diet consists of all the nourishment that is needed to nourish the body, the tissues of the body, which may be like the vitamins, the minerals, fibers and such.
A balanced diet is food which consists of all the different food groups. Nutrition then that from food that is from all the different food groups. That's what I think is a balanced diet.
Eating the right stuff like vitamins, minerals and iron.
Balanced diet is a group of food that give a balanced diet. You eat different food, make it food balance, so have a balanced diet.
We've seen that a number of people are not quite clear as to what a proper diet is. There's a lot of confusion out there because they say sugar is bad, salt is bad, eat plenty of vegetables, you know? So
yes.
There's a lot of confusion
out there, and there are many diets out there. I mean, people mm-hmm. are. I mean, if this one here is, if you go into and you go on the internet and you type in diet, you probably get a few million diets, and these are different diets. So obviously, because it's coming from both official source, non-official source,
yeah.
because there's no clear-cut diet that is doing very well, and this again contributes to the confusion.
Mm-hmm.
So nobody is clear in their mind exactly what is a proper diet.
Okay, so that's why we're doing this series, going back to the manual, finding the principles so we could end up with a proper diet to optimize our health.
So one of the points that we have shown so far,
mm-hmm.
a proper diet requires a heavy breakfast, 6 mornings per week, and
before
this should be
noon.
Consumed before 12 noon,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm. All right, so let's see another principle. Continuing in Exodus 16, what does this passage have to say about fasting and the pattern of eating? We'll be looking at verses 29 and 30 to find out how often we should fast on the sabbatical diet. Verse 29 says, "See, For that the Lord hath given you the Sabbath. Therefore he giveth you on the sixth day the bread of 2 days. Abide ye every man in his place. Let no man go out of his place on the seventh day. Verse 30, so the people rested on the seventh day.
Right.
So we see this is a different day.
Yes, the seventh day obviously is not treated like the other 6 days. Now, from this passage, you observe that they collect double portion of the manna on the sixth day. No, they didn't go out on the seventh day to collect. One of the issues, though, is that it's not clear from this passage exactly when did they consume this food on the seventh day.
Yes.
And what we did, we went back into the traditional history, and we went back into how the Jews normally practice the Sabbath. You had done some work on that, and what did you find when you...
We found that the Sabbath starts on the Friday evening and ends on Saturday evening. No meal was eaten in the morning before lunch on the Sabbath day. They ate meals Friday evening and Saturday at lunchtime and in the evening. So using this, the sabbatical diet has adapted it to say that on your fasting day, you don't eat anything until 12 noon.
Right. Well, what you found, the reason why they didn't eat any food in the morning is very important to point out, because there were a number of rituals that had to take place, including sacrificing animals,
washings
and so on. So by the time all this was finished, it was in the evening. So it's very rarely that anybody would have even eaten lunchtime. Most people probably started to eat maybe like 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock in the evening, because there's a lot of rituals and things that were involved and so on.
Okay.
So although some people might have eaten at lunchtime, nobody, based on our research, had anything to eat before 12. And the traditional Sabbath has been like that. I don't know how much the Jews practice that now, because there's so many variations now. But the original Sabbath, as how Moses had instructed, did not involve any consumption of meal in the morning. So that on that seventh day, they fasted to at least lunchtime. Some people probably fasted until late in the evening.
So on the sabbatical diet, we could go past 12 o'clock.
Well,
we don't have to stop and break the fast at 12.
No, you don't have to stop and break the fast at 12, but it's very important that you fast until 12. Because again, we'll show when we start to look at the science why this is critical and so on.
Okay, so we've seen that we have to eat a heavy breakfast 6 mornings. Huh. 1 morning, just as how the Sabbath was the same day, the morning we pick, we stick with it, and we don't eat anything before 12. Now, let's get an idea of what we are supposed to eat on our heavy breakfast morning. So we go back to Exodus 16. How does this passage describe the manna? The manna was the food God told them over and over, we're going to eat manna in the morning. So we'll be looking at verse 31. It says, and the house of Israel called the name thereof manna, and it was like coriander seed, white, and the taste of it was like wafers made with honey.
Okay.
So we have an example. We need foods that are similar to seeds,
right.
And we need some sweet stuff in there as well.
Right, a seed is a grain, and I mean, we're probably not familiar with coriander seed, but we are familiar with a lot of grains.
Yes,
you think of corn, that's a popular grain we consume. Think of rice and so on. And the basic structure or constituents of grains are very similar. So if you understand what corn looks like, what rice looks like, you have an idea what coriander seed looks like. Now, seeds in general are very high in starch. The dominant component of seeds is starch. It also contains some protein. It also contains some fat and so on. Our oils, you know, a lot of our oils come from seeds, like corn oil and so on. So what you see in that the manna itself was very high in carbohydrate, very high in starch. But not only was it high in starch, because the passage goes on, as you notice, they said, they also describe it like wafers made with honey. We all know honey is sweet, honey is like sugar. So we are saying that the meal was very starchy, and it also was very sweet. So you have a high both starch and sugars in it. Now that is very important, and when we come into the science, because there's something that starch does. When you consume have a heavy intake of starch, what you're actually doing, you're initiating an insulin called long-acting insulin. Now, long-acting insulin is the insulin that encourages your body to make protein. So what this diet is suggesting is that you're going to eat food that is going to encourage protein production.
Yeah.
Another important thing is that when you eat sugary meals, especially in the morning, it causes another type of insulin to release called short-acting insulin. Now, while long-acting insulin encourages your body to make protein, a high level of short-acting insulin in the morning switch off fat metabolism. In other words, it stops your body from making fat. So what you notice, if you consume this heavy food in the morning, you'll be encouraging your body to make protein and discouraging your body in making fat. So you can see the science is actually working out based just on how the manna is structured here. See?
Well, this is probably shocking to quite a few people, because a lady called me this week complaining bitterly about us having cornstarch and sugary stuff in the weight loss product.
Okay.
And she informed me that fat and sugar don't go together, you know. If you're fat, you're not supposed to touch sugar.
Okay.
But if God made us, and this is the kind of food he gave us, that's what we need. And the science is bearing it out, like you said.
But again, yes, sugars can form fat. But it all depends on what time you took the sugar. And that's where the pattern comes in, you know. Your metabolism is not the same 24 hours, your hormone.
Right.
And we're going to get a lot of that when you start to deal with the science of the diet and so on. But right now, we're just trying to get the instructions from the Bible to see how we can move forward.
Okay, so we see that the morning food, we need
high starch, high sugar, right.
And Exodus 16 mentions that God gave them quails in the evening.
Yes.
So, what are quails?
Well, quails are birds. You know, these are some small birds. There was a time in Jamaica we used to grow quails, you know. I remember some time ago.
Yes, I remember.
Right,
in the 80s, there was a quail farm in Clarendon.
Yeah, but I don't know if anybody does quails again. But there are some small birds, though. And basically, it's meat. So, you're looking at a high protein in the evening.
Okay.
Right.
But let's look at the evening meal and see what is said in verse 8,
right.
And Moses said, "This shall be when the Lord shall give you in the evening flesh to eat, and in the morning bread to the full."
Right. An important point you should note there is that while Moses is telling them that the breakfast should be eaten to the full, no quantity is ascribed to the quails. You don't say eat the quails to the full in the evening and so on. You just say eat some quails in the evening. So you can see the quantity aspect of it is not as critical as in the case of the breakfast and the morning and so on. And we don't see any instruction here at all that if you didn't eat the quails, there would be an issue.
Problems,
but
right.
if you think about it from a scientific point of view, and you want to choose a food in the evening to take advantage of your repairs overnight, the most likely thing your body will run short of is protein. It's very unlikely it's going to run short of calories at that time, but it's very likely to run short of critical amino acids.
Right.
So if you are going to choose a food to eat in the evening, the best food will be one that has a high quality protein, as a matter of fact.
Okay. Verse 12 reemphasizes it, saying, "At even ye shall eat flesh, and in the morning ye shall be filled with bread." So we see no specification
again
in the evenings again. So it is not mandatory.
Right.
But again, it works with the science, because science will tell you protein in the evening will be a better choice.
We have good advantage.
So we have the morning meal and we have the evening meal. And we have the fasting.
The fasting, right.
So the sabbatical diet, what is it?
Okay, what you could say the sabbatical diet is like a modern adaptation of Exodus 16. Right? Mm-hmm. What we're looking at the non-negotiable instructions in this passage, right? And we are taking those non-negotiable instructions and put it on the table and arrange it on the table as a diet and so on.
Okay.
And there are two non-negotiable instructions that we brought out. One is that you should have a heavy breakfast in the morning to the full, according to your needs. And you must have that meal before 12 o'clock. And as I said, with science will show why. And you should have that heavy meal 6 mornings for the week, right? So that's the first instruction. And the second instruction now, that on your 7th day or your Sabbath, you do the opposite. Rather than eating, you are now fasting, and you should not consume any food before 12 noon on the 7th day.
Now, if we're going to follow a diet, it must be simple. It must be affordable.
Yes.
We're not counting any set of calories and restricting a whole lot of stuff.
Right.
So, again, God made us. He knows us. And he knows that this diet we could live on comfortably.
Yes, yes.
So,
yes.
In summary, Exodus 16 and the sabbatical diet is what we looked at today. We see that God gives a practical demonstration of the pattern of food consumption when he was feeding the children of Israel in the desert.
Yes, that's right.
And he also provided a guide as to the type of food we should have for breakfast and for dinner.
Right.
So, we are thoroughly informed as to how we should go about feeding ourselves.
Right. And this information has been in the Bible from ever since. I mean, Moses probably wrote this at least maybe 6,000 years ago. So the information has been there. The problem is that we have ignored the Bible as a source to guide us in our science. And that's why we are there struggling and trying all different types of diet and so on. And I mean, the statistics right now on success in obesity is less than 2%. Less than 2%. And what's interesting, the 2% that succeed, they are people who are very heavy into exercise, heavy into watching calories. I mean, their entire life is stressed out trying to keep
it.
The majority of people will definitely not go in that direction. No.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So we see we have the sabbatical diet, which is livable, but just as how the early scientists, they showed that God's word and his work go together. We need to know that the science backs up this diet. So next week, we're going to be examining the scientific basis of the diet in preventing and reversing obesity and other chronic diseases like diabetes, hypertension, high cholesterol, heart disease. So join us next week as we look at the science behind this wonderful diet, and you could go ahead and start the diet in the meanwhile, and we'll keep guiding you as you go along. So thanks again for joining us as we looked at how to improve our health using biblical principles. I'm Arlene Robinson with Dr. Robinson. We'll see you next week.